welcome to Treasury Notes, a show dedicated to the latest news and information from the office of West Virginia State Treasurer John Perdue. I'm your host, Gina Long. For high school seniors around the state, it's not too early to start thinking about higher education. In fact, many high school seniors and their parents have been preparing for years to make sure they're headed in the right direction. Coming up this half hour, we'll talk to certified educational planner Jamie Dickinson. She'll have more on the importance of saving for a college education, when you should start, and the ways you can do that with the Smart 529 College Savings Program. But first, we want to tell you about some other news making headlines this month in the State Department of Treasury. A Marion County woman is now the oldest person in West Virginia's recorded history to receive unclaimed property from the state treasurer's office. To recognize the milestone, Treasurer Perdue showed up in person to present the 102-year-old her unclaimed property check. Here's more.
We're going to present you a check of $507.
At age 102, Zelma Fraley is now the oldest recipient of unclaimed property on record in the state of West Virginia. To mark the milestone, State Treasurer John Perdue showed up in person at Fraley's home in the Marion County town of Berwickville to present her with the check for $507. Fraley said she was excited about the visit.
It was a big surprise, I'll tell you.
Four generations of Fraley's family gathered for the celebration. In fact, Fraley's 81-year-old daughter, Gypsy Conaway, found her mother's name in the most recent unclaimed property bulletin published in the newspaper. Conaway recited a poem in her mother's honor.
Her name being a ton, Zelma Hun, mother and nanny, has changed. But for 50-some years, the name Nanny has remained.
The unexpected check came from a matured life insurance policy. Fraley is already deciding how she will spend the money.
What are you going to spend that on?
Probably the grandkids.
Grandkids for Christmas?
Yeah, probably the grandkids.
You're not going to spend any on me?
No.
Oh, okay.
Treasurer Perdue's unclaimed property program is routinely among the nation's leaders when it comes to rate of return. His office keeps an extensive database of those for whom the office is holding unclaimed property. Before Fraley, the oldest person in state history to receive unclaimed property was Mary Chester of Institute. She was 101 when her check was presented in 2008. For more information on unclaimed property or to see if you have unclaimed property, just log on to our website at www.wvtreasury.com. Here are some statistics on the Treasurer's Unclaimed Property Program. The state currently holds approximately 780,000 unclaimed property accounts. That adds up to about $156 million in unclaimed property funds. Since 2007, the Treasurer's Office has returned $35 million to unclaimed property owners. The state has collected in excess of more than $73 million from holders. Again, if you're interested in unclaimed property, you should log on to our website, wvtreasury.com, to do an unclaimed property search, or you can call 1-800-642-8687 for more information. The treasurer's push to bring financial education to all West Virginia schools is gaining ground. The Net Worth program allows teachers to integrate financial learning into their already established everyday curriculum. Right now, program officials are doing county-by-county training with teachers around the state. Recently, some of those teachers gathered at a summit in Charleston to learn more about the core concepts of the program. Here's a closer look.
The younger you can teach financial education, the better off you is going to be.
State Treasurer John Perdue says financial education needs to be an integral part of West Virginia's school system. That's why he developed the Net Worth program, which is designed to improve and expand personal finance education in the state's public schools. To help make this happen, dozens of teachers gathered in Charleston recently to learn more about the core concepts of financial education. Those concepts are earn, spend, save, borrow, and protect. National and state financial leaders spoke at the summit, including a member of the FDIC. The nation's largest independent regulator for securities firms, FINRA also had a representative on hand to talk about outsmarting investment fraud. The summit was all part of the first Money Smart Week West Virginia. The week offered free classes designed to help people better manage their personal finances. The Treasurer's Office joined up with other governmental agencies and AARP to help sponsor the event. For more information about net worth and the state's financial education programs, log on to our website at www.wvtreasury.com. Teacher training is only one leg of the net worth program. Another feature of the program is the hands-on learning simulations. This school year, there are dozens of Get a Life budget simulations scheduled for middle schools across the state. Here's more from one of those events.
I don't want to get in debt or anything.
Lily Jacobs, a seventh grade student at Horace Mann Middle School in Charleston, says she doesn't want to be another statistic. That's why she appreciates this budget simulation called Get a Life.
I think this game is really teaching us a lot about how our parents have to spend their money on us.
Jacobs and other students at middle schools around the state are participating in the simulation as a component of State Treasurer John Perdue's Net Worth Program, which integrates financial education into the classroom. Teachers say the real-world application is the biggest benefit.
Anytime that we can bring in relevancy for kids and how things apply to real life, it really strikes a chord with them.
Assistant Principal Josh Stauer says it's a community effort to teach the next generation.
Financial literacy is one of the 21st century goals of the State Department of Education Institutes. And to be able to have a program like this with the Treasurer's Office that actually goes out into the field, into the schools, and applies these financial applications on an age-appropriate level is critical.
And for some students, that message hits home.
I didn't know dental insurance and vision insurance cost so much.
For more information on net worth and financial education, call the Treasurer's Office at 304-558-5000 or log on to our website. And of course, we do have a schedule of all those Get a Life events on our website, so check out that for more information. Well, anyone who knows how to budget their money wisely also knows the importance of saving. And if your plans include a college education for your family or a family member, saving is a key element. Coming up, we'll talk with a local expert on college preparation. She'll talk more about the best ways to save and how to achieve those goals of a higher education. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
We find all kinds of items, and that becomes unclaimed property, and it mounts into millions of dollars. It could be stock, it could be CDs, but it could also be a diamond ring or a gold watch of your dad's. We returned over $50 million to the people of West Virginia. I'm proud of that. You can go on our website. You can look at the names and see if your name's on there or someone that you recognize. We set the standard in a nation in returning unclaimed property.
Welcome back to Treasury Notes, a show designed to update you on the latest news and information from the Office of West Virginia State Treasurer John Perdue. Once again, I'm your host, Gina Long. Well, most employers will tell you that some type of education after high school is pretty much a must these days. And that means students and their parents need to prepare themselves early on for how they will get that education. Joining me now to talk a little bit more about that issue is Certified Educational Planner Jamie Dickinson. Jamie, thank you so much for joining us here today.
Thank you for having me. I haven't been here in a while. It's nice to be back.
Well, it's nice to have you back on the program, and this is the first time I've had the chance to interview you. So there's a lot of questions I have for you and a little bit about what you do. I just wanted to start out by talking about the importance of higher education. Why is it so important, and what are some of the things people can do to prepare?
Well, you know, I grew up in southern West Virginia, so being highly educated was something that my parents preached to me from the beginning. And you know, now as you get older, you really see the whole reason you have to be in higher education is to get a job. I mean, the whole reason kids go to college is to get a job and to earn a living, and especially for the state of West Virginia. We need educated citizens. I mean, if we want to take this state forward, you know, our children need to be educated. And so When you start talking about higher education, you're talking about parents' two most precious assets, their kids and their money. I mean, what else is there? People will do anything for their kids. And so now when you look at the cost of college, I saw a quote in the Chronicles of Higher Education that said, if the cost of college had gone, if a gallon of milk had gone up at the rate of the cost of college has, we'd be paying $30 a gallon for milk. So what people have to understand is you can worry about gas prices and all of this, but you really need to worry about the cost of college. Because it can be anywhere now from $60,000 over 4 years at an in-state school to above $250,000 out of state at some of the really mega selective colleges. So when you're talking anywhere from $60,000 to $250,000 in an undergraduate education, people really need to take the time to sit down, to look at all their options and figure out how they're going to finance that.
And when you talk about planning, I'm sure the earlier the better. And we should note that it doesn't matter what type of higher education you decide on, right? Because a lot of times students think that it's just about saving for college, but it's not always just about college. There are lots of technical schools and other things that you can save for as well.
And, you know, and I love the community colleges. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're a great step up for kids that maybe struggled a little bit in high school and just don't feel comfortable making that big leap into it at a university level. You've got the career and technical programs. You have numerous things for higher education. Now everything's online. You can even do online programs, you know, from wherever you are. So there are many different types of higher education, and there are different ways to save for that. And the thing about it is this, is if you don't save for college, then the federal government comes in and loans you the money at an 8.45% now. So most parents need to understand it's either pay me now or pay me later. You can save for college now or you can borrow it at a much higher interest rate. But at some point, you're going to have to get to the point that you're going to have to figure out how you're going to pay for college.
It's such a challenge for so many West Virginia families to start saving now, because getting that momentum to start putting money away for college is a hard thing to do. It's hard to say, I know we're going to need this later, but I'm going to put it away now.
You know, I tell everybody the two hardest things I do in my life are keep my weight down and get to the end of the money and keep money keep money in the bank. And I'm highly educated in both of those. So, you know, when you understand about saving money, when you're a financial advisor, it's hard to tell a family, should you save for your emergency fund? Should you save for your retirement? Should you save for your education, for your kids' education? It's very difficult to stretch a dollar that far. And sometimes people don't know how to do it, or second of all, they're not disciplined enough to do it. And so when you approach a family about how are you going to do this, it's very scary for them because, you know, there is no financial aid for retirement. So you have to plan for retirement. So, you know, I have people say, well, we can always take money off our retirement account. Well, yes, you can, but then what are you going to do when you retire?
Right.
So if you think your kids will take care of you, okay, but normally that doesn't happen.
Always something to think about. Something else you have to think about is, as a student, you're preparing pretty much your entire life to get to college. You're preparing once you get into grade school, middle school, and then high school. So when is it a good time for parents to start thinking about preparing in the form of saving up or in the form of just making sure that their kids are going to be ready to go to college?
You know, I tell everybody when we talk about college, we talk about three things. First of all, the student's ability to get in. And that's what most people focus on in this marketing frenzy of it's so difficult to get into college. Second of all, and for me what's most important, is that the kids have the ability to stay in school, that they're academically prepared to stay in. Because it doesn't do you any good for the kids to get in and then they can't handle it academically. Then you've wasted your money. And third, mom and dad have to be able to afford it. We can't have mom and dad broke by the time the kids get out of school. So until you know all those three of those things, that the kids are in, that they can stay in, and that you can afford it, you really can't figure out where your kids are going to go to college. And I think people don't plan enough for college. They'll stick their head in the sand. Oh, senior year, okay, we'll go to Marshall, WVU, Wesleyan, Concord. And that's still a huge amount of money. So even after the promised scholarship in-state at WVU, Marshall, Concord, you're still looking around $10,000. So you're still looking at $40,000 out of pocket, even after that. So if I would talk to parents, I would tell them, let me tell you something. You need to make sure your kids make good grades. Because the majority of financial aid is given out now, and the scholarship opportunity is based on merit. Promise Scholarship is a merit-based scholarship program. It's based on the kids' grades and their test scores. Mom and dad can be rich, mom and dad can be poor, they still get the money. So the majority of money now is given out on a merit basis. So as your kids are coming up through grade school, as your kids are getting into middle school, if they start struggling in classes, get them tutored. Because as long as they make A's and B's, you probably will be able to help, they will be able to with their grades to help you afford college.
And if they're smart kids, if you know, little Johnny's on the right track, he's doing all the right things, he gets straight A's, I'm sure he's gonna get a Promise Scholarship or some other grant out there. That's not enough, is it?
No, and you know, it's amazing to me still yet, the Promise Scholarship came in 2001. It's amazing to me how many people still think that that's a four-year free ride. I mean, it's just tuition, which is only a fraction of what they have to pay. So you are correct. People don't really understand, okay, well, he's smart, so he's okay. Well, there are some kids, they're the average kids. You know, they've got to go to school too. And people always say to me, well, you know, you've got the low-income kids. The low-income kids are going to qualify for all of the financial aid. They're going to be fine. You've got the wealthy kids. Okay, they can afford it. They're going to be fine. It's that middle slice of American families. It's the people that are dual income that make just enough money that will be broke by putting their kids through school. It's that sure. middle income that really is feeling the brunt of paying for higher education.
So one of the best programs I think we have here at the Treasurer's Office, of course, is the Smart 529 College Savings Plan. Let's talk a little bit about that and why it's such a good way for parents and students to invest, and what are some of the ways they can do that?
You know, since John Perdue has been treasurer, we are so blessed with all of the programs that he's put in as far as, you know, saving for college. Anybody that did the prepaid tuition plan really needs to pat themselves on the back, because that prepaid tuition plan has pretty much doubled your investment. That was fabulous. You know, that plan stopped back when the Promise Scholarship came in, and then he put in the Smart 529 College Savings Plan. What a blessing for the people of West Virginia to be able to save money at a tax-deferred basis. And prepare for college, because like I say, if you don't save your money, you know, you're going to have to borrow it, which is really not much of a different option, I don't think, because, you know, then you're paying 8.45% interest. I mean, the interest rates on student loans are extremely high.
Yeah, I always tell everybody I'm going to be paying back my student loans for the rest of my life. If I would have had something like the Smart 529 Savings Plan, if my parents would have invested in something like that, you just are so much better off in the long run, because you're getting that money at a lower rate. And like you said, there are a lot of tax advantages to investing in a program like a Smart 529.
You know, and every state has a 529, but if you live in West Virginia, I think it would be really hard to look at other states' plans, because we've got the tax advantage on your West Virginia estate tax return, you know, of lowering your adjusted gross income. That is so important. So yeah, and it's a great plan, first of all. I mean, it's got very varied options in it. It's got different sub-accounts that you can look at to go in. It's even got that age-based portfolio, which I like, because it will automatically rebalance itself. And so what happens is people may go into a Smart 529 plan when the kids are young and be really aggressive about it. And if they go on with life and they forget to go back and look at rebalancing their assets, they may get up to, you know, junior and senior year and have their money invested really aggressively. And then if there's a big drop in the market, like what happened in the last couple of years, you know, they could lose half of their money. But so that age-based portfolio automatically backs it down and makes it a little bit more conservative as the kids get older. And I think that's a fabulous option in the 529 as well. So that is such a nice program. You know what I do? Whenever any of my friends have babies or invite me to baby showers, I always open them, give them a check and say, here, this is for your 529. So don't waste a lot of money on toys, because those kids don't know about the toys. They'd rather play in the box and put money in their college savings plan.
You know, that's a good point. We always talk about the fact that it's never too early to start a savings account for college. It's never too early. But what about being too late? When is it really too late to start investing in a smart 529?
You know, it's not even too late when the kids are in college. You know, if you have to pay money for tuition, books, supplies, you can open your 529 account, put the money in, pay it out, you still get your West Virginia tax advantage. Right. Even if you don't do anything but just, you know, use it as a vehicle to flush it through. But I was at the gym and one of the girls said, and she is single, and she said, you know, I wanted to start saving for college because hopefully I will get married and have a baby, and I didn't know what to do. I was like, you can save in the 529 plan even if you save for yourself. Or put, you know, the beneficiaries, the niece or nephew, everybody can get into the 529.
Another cool thing about the Smart 529 is once you open it, say you are, you know, a young adult and you want to open that because you might go back to school, but then that never happens. Once you have children, you can transfer it to their name, correct?
Right, you just change the beneficiary. Yeah. So you are always the owner. And you know, in my day, a lot of parents opened, you hear people talk about UGMAs, and that's the Uniform Gift to Minors Act. And what happened though is when the student turned 18, that money became their asset. So if they wanted to take that money out and spend it, they could. Whereas this way, if you're in a 529 and the parent is the owner, and then the student can't do anything with it. So let's say that you have two kids and the first one may get a fabulous scholarship and doesn't need it. You can either save it for graduate school or you can transfer the beneficiary to the second child. I mean, there's so many things that you can do with it. It's so versatile.
And now I think there's an even better reason to invest in a Smart 529 because we have a brand new partnership with You Promise Rewards. A lot of West Virginians are already enrolled in that program and now they can take those rewards and roll them over into a Smart 529 account. Talk a little bit about this new partnership and what you think it's going to mean for the program.
If I had to explain it in a simple way, I would tell you it's like a frequent flyer plan for, you know, for saving for college. So everybody understands, you know, if you're gonna fly on an airline, get your frequent flyer miles. So here's what it is. You Promise started back in 2001, actually. So it's been around for a while. And what you do is you just go to the website. I mean, you probably have the website for people and log in and create an account and sign up for You Promise. If you already have a 529 account through the state of West Virginia, you can register it to automatically transfer your earnings from your You Promise account directly into your 529. Then you can go ahead and start getting your earnings on that account. So it automatically transfers in there, which I think is so wonderful. So you don't even have to remember to go out and transfer it out. And most of the vendors, I mean, you know, you can look at the vendors online, but there are quite a few of them. So if you buy groceries and gas and, you know, eat out, all of the things that we all do, now as you do that, you can save money for college. So a portion of that, and it depends on the vendor, whether it's 2% or 4% of your bill, goes into your You Promise account, then which goes directly into your 529 account. I think it's a fabulous idea.
And really the way this works is you sign up for it online, as you said, and then you go in and you just sign up your different credit cards or your bank cards that you have.
Right.
And the way I understand it is once you go shopping at certain stores, maybe you shop online, buy certain products, that's how you receive those rewards. And it's free money, right?
It's free money. And, you know, people be like, how do they do that? Well, you know, it's the vendors who are encouraging this. And it's because they believe in higher education. And, you know, they want you to be a customer and they want the repeat business to come back. But it is very easy. Yes, you just take all of your credit cards or your debit card or whatever it is and register it, and then anytime you use it, if it's at a qualified vendor, you get your percentages. I just think it's a great idea. It's kind of like one of those brainless things.
Yeah.
Like that once you set it up, you don't have to think about it.
And I think it's also another reason to open a Smart 529 account. If you don't have a lot of money to invest, if you're really worried saying, I want to open a Smart 529 account, but you know what? I'm not sure I'm going to be able to put money back all the time, and I don't want it to be a waste. This is one more thing to encourage you.
You know, you can open a 529 account with $50. So, you know, normally at birthdays, Christmas, I mean, the kids get money.
Yeah.
So if I were them, I would say, okay, if you've got $100 for Christmas, we'll put $50 into your smart 529 account, and then you can take the other $50 and you can do with it whatever you want. So if you get that child used to saving a portion of their income, whether it's when they go to work and they do it, or somebody gives them a gift to do it, then I think that kids will get excited about the fact that there's a little girl at my church always runs over and goes, I put money in my 529 account, Jamie. I'm like, I'm so proud of you.
And you are proud
fabulous.
Of her.
I'm
proud,
proud
of her for doing that. That means that she's mindful of what it costs to go to college. And she's trying. She's trying to get there. I think it's something that parents can encourage their children to do as well.
You know, I'm going to tell you something. I don't think that families talk enough about this. And this is a huge expense. And, you know, I think that over dinner, parents need to sit down and have a serious conversation with their kids, because teenagers understand money, whether you believe it or not. Teenagers really understand money. And, you know, if a student is so lucky that the parents say, we've been saving our whole life and you don't have to worry about it, but that's normally not the case. I mean, even higher income people are struggling now. I mean, in my office every day, I see it. People are really struggling to put their kids through college and to pay for college. And then you get to grad school. I was just on the phone yesterday with one of my students who's graduating, and she's applying to law school, and she was in tears. She goes, I just sat down and figured out that by the time I get through law school, I'm gonna be $200,000 in debt.
Wow.
And she said, I don't even know if I should go to law school. I mean, so when you think that kids may be coming out of school in as much debt as people pay for a house, how can you not sit down and think about it? How can you not save for it? How can you ignore it and pretend that it is going to go away? Because it is not going to go away.
And there's help for people who don't feel that they can make these decisions on their own. I know you as a certified educational planner can help these parents, but there's also investment professionals connected with the Smart 529 plan who can help.
Absolutely. I mean, the state treasurer has done a great job in ensuring that people have good, solid financial advice. As you know, you can't stand over the water cooler and listen, well, I did this and I did that, and then you just get so confused that you don't know what you're supposed to do. So I would tell everybody to consult a professional, because even those of us who are in the business sometimes struggle with decisions. Should we go this way? Should we go that way? And so, yes, everybody really should look for good professional advice.
And very quickly before I let you go, I just want to remind everyone that Christmas is right around the corner. Great opportunity to give a gift. Give the gift of knowledge, we like to say.
I say give the gift of learning and love, too.
So learning just
open
and love.
Up, learning and love. Open up 529 account, especially for grandparents.
Yeah.
Do you know how grandparents struggle so much? Like, what are we going to give our teenager?
Oh,
so,
yeah.
You know, just open up a 529 account and let them go off and be highly educated and have a successful life, because that's what it's all about.
Jamie, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks
here
today. Thanks for having me.
Well, that wraps up today's show. Remember, you can always get the latest news, information, and events from the State Treasurer's Office on our website at www.wvtreasury.com. I want to thank the staff here at the West Virginia Library Commission, keeping you informed on the Library Television Network. I'm Gina Long with the West Virginia State Treasurer's Office.